Fossil fuels are the mainstay of our economy. Every day we get into our cars, we switch on the light, we turn up the heating, and we cook our meals. At the same time, we know that for the import of our fuels, we're becoming more and more dependent on a number of places in the world that are not always a model of stability. What we don't realize is how vulnerable the system is that our energy supply is based on. What would happen if one day the supply of our oil or natural gas came to a complete standstill?
If you're highly dependent on one place and one supplier and one of everything, that's, to my experience, not a good place to be strategically.
This is a situation that sooner or later somebody gives. It's like building a very tall building without good architectural plan.
To me, that's the significant issue that kind of drives me a little bit, is why, knowing that we're so vulnerable, why haven't we done something to change?
The transition of fossil fuels to alternative forms of energy is not only a matter of environmental management, it's increasingly becoming a strategic necessity. How will this crucial change develop in the next few decades? Will the change be based on the harmony model, as most people hope? Or will the transition involve a conflict model instead?
Ik denk dat het een probleem is wat voor conflicten kan zorgen in de komende tijd. En ik ben daar liever wat beter op voorbereid. En misschien dat je dat, doordat iedereen erkent dat het een conflictueus probleem is, dat je het dan nog misschien kan oplossen in multilaterale verbanden, dan dat je het laat gebeuren en in alle naïviteit er niet op let en dan allerlei ongelukken maakt.
Kobi van der Linde, director of the Klingendael International Energy Program, is an expert on the relationship between energy and geopolitics.
Transitie klinkt als een soort kabbelend proces en dat vanzelf alles goed komt. Ja, als je in de geschiedenis terugkijkt, dan is de geschiedenis kan best heel rauw zijn. En ja, wie zegt dat de toekomst niet net zo rauw is als het om dit soort processen gaat? Toevallig is het zo dat daar waar de grote gas- en oliereserves liggen, ja, dat ligt in een ellips die van het Midden-Oosten, zo over de Kaspische Zee, tot in Siberië reikt. En daar ligt toch zo'n beetje 70% van de bekende reserves. Dat is dus een hele cruciale regio waar iedereen dus ook politiek aan het manoeuvreren is om daar toch maar een greep op die regio te houden. En vooral omdat het militaire apparaat heel erg afhankelijk is van energie. En dan hebben we het over de strategische belangen van staten. Ja, dan moet je wel nadenken over van hoe ze dat dan zullen gaan oplossen. En dat kan vreedzaam en dat kan via een economische route. En soms, je kan je ook voorstellen dat dat misschien wat minder aardig gaat.
Just imagine the worst case scenario. One day, the supply of our oil and natural gas comes to a complete standstill. Does Europe have a contingency plan ready? And what kind of conflicts could break out? What would happen if, somewhere far away in Uzbekistan, a pipeline was blown up in an area that is so crucial to the natural gas supply to the West that the supply to Europe could be jeopardized?
აფეთქებები მაგისტრალურ გასადენზე გამთენიისას მოხდა. დაახლოებით 3 საათზე რუსულმა მხარემ დააფიქსირა წნევის ძლიერი ვარდნა და მაშინვე მიიღო გადაწყვეტილება ბუნებრივი აირის გადაკეტვის შესახებ.
По словам заместителя генпрокурора Николая Шепеля, на основной и резервной линиях газопровода были подорваны самодельные бомбы.
We asked the following energy experts. John Roberts, a Russia specialist and natural gas expert with Platts, the London-based international consultancy agency for energy issues.
If I'm assuming that it is indeed winter, that's very serious indeed. that peak demand for Russia, for the countries beyond Russia, and for China.
Edward Lucas, correspondent for The Economist. Lucas wrote the book The New Cold War on the dangers of Russia as a natural gas power.
And the pipeline stops flowing, then the person who receives gas through the pipeline is in a really difficult position. You can't just get on the phone and order some truckloads of gas the way you can do it if it's soap or champagne.
I'm Mikhail Delyagin, director of IPROG, the Russian think tank for globalization issues in Moscow.
Мы не можем вылечить вот эти вот европейские страхи, потому что они находятся не в области газа, не в области энергетической политики, а в области психиатрии.
Russian jet fighters have hit several targets in the Fergana Valley in Uzbekistan today. International leaders are worried that the conflict in Uzbekistan might turn into a regional war involving Turkmenistan, Kazakhstan, Tajikistan, Russia, and China. As a reaction to the conflict, the Uzbekistan government has decided to close off the transition hub at Khiva. It is part of the Russian Central Asia Center pipeline. The CAC pipeline is crucial for the transport of gas by Russia to Europe. Due to the Uzbekistan boycott, the Russian gas supply has been cut by 25%. Russia is now having grave problems in meeting its gas deliveries to Europe.
It means that Russia's consumers go short. It means that European consumers go short. This is the time when you want every scrap of gas available. For Gazprom, it might have to invoke force majeure. In theory, it should continue to honor its contracts to Europe. In practice, if it does so, then it is telling its own customers, the Russian domestic market, you must take the entire shock yourself, because we're not going to pass any of the shock on to Europe. I don't think that is politically doable by Russia.
And so if there's a limited amount of gas, you're going to get quite a severe conflict between, say, Ukraine, Poland and Germany, where someone is going to go short of gas. Who's it going to be? The Germans who pay the most, or the Poles and then the Ukrainians who are closest, furthest upstream and are most able to siphon it off? If the gas is blocked for months or even a year or so, then you have a real problem, because you have very big economic damage is going to be borne by somebody, and the question is, who's it going to be borne by?
I think what it really boils down to is a question of sheer practical clout, which is namely, if you're Germany, Russia will want to strike a deal with you. But are they going to care that much about being as fair to Bosnia-Herzegovina as they are to Germany?
Ukraine, Slovenia, Hungary, Bulgaria, and Poland are already completely cut off from the Russian gas supply. Turkey and Greece have expressed their concern that if the Uzbekistan gas boycott continues, they too will be in short supply.
And then, of course, the question would be, well, what price does Russia want for the gas? And you might then have Russia saying, OK, we will restart gas deliveries to Poland, but at a much higher price in return for a big chunk of Poland's energy infrastructure. Because I think, really, Gazprom is not a company. It's more like a ministry. It's the gas ministry of the old Soviet Union, but listed on the New York and London stock exchanges. It's a new kind of animal, and I think we should look at it much more in terms of a state agency with a hefty dose of intelligence gathering, and also to some extent as a kind of cartel, or if one wants to be unflattering, almost a kind of mafia syndicate.
Газпром это не министерство, это открытое акционерное общество, которое существует по корпоративному праву. С участием иностранных инвесторов. Европеец не может понять, что продажа газа Европе, для нас это не продажа газа. Вот для нас это получение денег. И без этих денег Россия существовать не может физически. Поэтому любое сокращение поставок газа в Европу – это финансовая катастрофа. Вы боитесь, это напоминает шизофрению. Вы у нас покупаете газ, и вы нас боитесь. Ребята, а не покупайте газ. В чем трудности? В чем трудности?
Pipeline politics is one of the instruments of Russian foreign policy, and it's basically aimed at increasing the dependence of European countries on monopoly Russian gas supplies. So it means building Nord Stream, which hooks up Germany to Russia directly and allows Russia to put therefore more pressure on the transit countries of Belarus, Poland, Ukraine, Czech Republic, Slovakia, and so on. It means trying to stop Nabucco, which is the West's best chance of having some independent east-west gas capacity. That's the pipeline from Central Asia and the Caucasus up through Turkey into the Balkans and then Central Europe. And Russia's done a very good job in blocking that. And it's done a good job in promoting its alternative of South Stream, which is a pipeline across the Black Sea, tremendously expensive, which would then send Russian gas into the Balkans and make Nabucco uneconomic. We have to diversify the sources of supply for all of Europe so we can get a wide range of supplies and not be so dependent on Russian supplies, particularly in the east.
Nederland gaat deelnemen in het miljardenproject Nordstrom, een 1200 kilometer lange pijplijn die Europa een directe verbinding geeft met de Russische gasvelden.
Meneer president, mag ik u heel hartelijk danken voor de gastvrijheid. Het is goed om weer terug te zijn in Moskou.
Ruime aandacht was er voor de hoofdprijs van de dag. Gazprom tekende een miljardencontract met de Gasunie.
Северная труба возникла потому, что Украина отказалась платить за российский газ и, пользуясь политической поддержкой Евросоюза, начала воровать газ, предназначенный для Евросоюза. И когда, значит, люди, которые пользовались политической поддержкой Евросоюза, украли газ у Евросоюза, Евросоюз сказал, что виноват в этом Россия. Россия предложила построить дополнительную трубу, чтобы не было проблем с Украиной, через Белоруссию и Польшу. А что Польша сказала? Нет. Это оккупация. Мы не хотим ничего русского на своей территории. Тогда ее стали строить в обход Польши. После чего Польша при поддержке США и Евросоюза начала орать, что это ущемление польских интересов. Вы разберитесь как-нибудь со своей внутренней шизофренией.
What Gazprom has seen, what Russia has seen, is that once you have a presence in a country's energy infrastructure and energy companies, you can then develop that into a political presence as well. We've begun to see that in Germany, for example, where Russia sees Germany as its most important partner within Europe. And that's a rather unhealthy symbiosis. And so we see a Nord Stream gas pipeline, which is very threatening for the energy security of countries like Poland, conceived in secret, supported by Gerhard Schröder when he was chancellor, and now being built by a consortium in which he's the chairman. And that really, you know, would strike some people as quite scandalous. And so I think that really exemplifies the way in which Russia has managed to get the top officials in European countries into this very unhealthy mixture of business and politics. And I've actually coined the name for this, the Schröderisatia, the Schröderization of Western Europe. We are losing the chance now to determine our own future in energy. And Gazprom, despite all its corruption and incompetence, is playing a much better game of chess than we are.
Европейцы как-то всегда... Понимаете, европейское сознание, оно очень эгоцентрично, потому что вся позиция Евросоюза заключается в том, что Россия не имеет права распоряжаться своим газом. Что вы должны делать со своим газом то, так и тогда, когда мы вам скажем. Вот в чем позиция Евросоюза.
Но я же не от имени Евросоюза, а от имени здорового рассудка.
Здоровый рассудок Вот это не позиция профсоюза. Вот. Это не физическая угроза. Это психологическое состояние людей,
да,
которые находятся в состоянии перманентной истерики. Коллеги, это не энергетическая политика. Это психиатрия.
The Russians know exactly how to play their cards. But what is Europe's answer?
We don't have a European answer. We don't even have a national answer because we are not suited. Our system is not set up to deal with this kind of hybrid commercial political approach from the Russians. And actually, we need to move away from gas altogether because gas is a great feedstock for petrochemicals. It's a very valuable thing. It doesn't really make sense to burn it for heating. This is a bit like burning vintage cognac to keep yourself warm.
So a natural gas crisis in the east would leave half of Europe out in the cold. But what about that other vulnerable lifeline, oil? Most of our oil is still transported by sea.
A Saudi oil tanker carrying 2 million barrels of oil has exploded and sunk in the Strait of Hormuz in the Persian Gulf. The 25 crew members appear not to have survived the incident. All sea traffic through the Persian Gulf has been severely disrupted. The Strait of Hormuz is one of the main arteries for the transport of oil from the Middle East.
Bad news.
We take a tour of international oil and defense experts to hear how such a crisis could develop.
I think it's very, very possible and more potential of happening than not.
Chuck Wald, also known as the Green Hawk, former general and member of the Military Advisory Board, a prestigious military think tank in Washington, D.C.
We'd prefer to try to resolve the situation with a minimum amount of force, as always, but we're prepared to do what it takes to keep the place open.
William Fallon, former admiral and formerly in charge of the American Central Command in Bahrain.
If this is an indefinite, prolonged, nasty confrontation with uncertain outcome, everybody is going to hoard the supplies.
Ariel Cohen, energy expert with the Heritage Foundation, a conservative think tank. He played a war simulation game to see what the impact of a lengthy oil embargo would be.
There is no limit, if you absolutely have to have the oil, to what you have to do to get it.
Yusuf Ibrahim gained experience in the Middle East as a correspondent for the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal.
If you try to close the Strait of Hormuz, prices will go bananas.
Axel Busch, an authority on the oil markets and energy expert of Energy Intelligence Consultancy Agency.
It will be like the Cold War between the US and Russia, where you had to worry all the time about a clash leading to a world war.
And Michael Clare, defense expert and author of the book Resource Wars. Clare predicts how the global energy shortage may inevitably lead to another world war.
According to naval authorities, the ship was hijacked yesterday off the coast of Iran and then loaded with explosives. The incident has been labeled a terrorist attack.
They're very good at what they do. They're highly, you know, they're very well armed. Tactically, they're very good. And so once they get to a point where they can board, it becomes very difficult to get them off.
I think the United States will be making a lot of calls. It depends on who gets to the phone first.
It'll be this famous 3 o'clock in the morning phone call, and it'll probably be from the admiral commanding the American fleet directly to the White House and the Central Intelligence Agency.
The United States will be calling China. The U.S. will be calling Russia. The United States will be calling Europe.
But there will also be a lot of phone calls going to all the heads of states around the Gulf, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, United Arab Emirates.
Well, I would call the commander of U.S. Naval Forces Central Command, who happens to be headquartered in Bahrain, to get from him a sense of what he has available in the way of resources and how quickly they might be able to deploy. There are certain places in the world, narrow channels between land masses, that are the most efficient routes for ships to travel. And we call these areas choke points. The majority of the oil and gas is coming out of the Gulf through this Strait of Hormuz, this narrow area between Iran, the UAE, and Oman.
Through that narrow strip of water flows something like 15 million barrels a day of oil, 90% of the Arab Gulf's daily production. That's a huge amount of oil.
Insurance companies have now added a war premium for all ships operating in the Persian Gulf. Analysts fear that it will take at least several weeks or even months before sea traffic can resume to normal through the Persian Gulf.
We tend to make sure from the United States Navy that we have assets, ships and airplanes out in these regions because they're the most important and the most critical and the most easily disrupted if somebody wanted to play that card.
And in 1978, then President Carter publicly declared the Carter Doctrine, which was basically his thoughts on the national security of the United States, that if energy was disrupted in the Middle East, the flow of oil, that the United States would use military force to ensure that free flow of oil.
It demands collective efforts to meet this new threat to security in the Persian Gulf and in Southwest Asia. It demands the participation of all those who rely on oil from the Middle East and who are concerned with global peace and stability. An attempt by any outside force to gain control of the Persian Gulf region will be regarded as an assault on the vital interests of the United States of America, and such an assault will be repelled by any means necessary, including military force.
So President Carter created the nucleus of a new military command, the Central Command, or CENTCOM, as it's called, that today are the most important military forces we have. Those are the forces that operate in Iraq and Afghanistan and throughout the entire Persian Gulf, Central Asian area. So a whole new military bureaucracy, new military establishment was created specifically for the purpose of protecting the flow of oil from the Persian Gulf through the Strait of Hormuz to the rest of the world.
Until now, no one has claimed responsibility for the act. But American and European intelligence services have strong indications that the action is backed by a fundamentalist faction within the Iranian Revolutionary Guard. The Iranian government have denied responsibility for the attack.
The U.S. naval capabilities in the Gulf are overwhelming. They're much, much stronger than whatever Iran can deploy. However, Iran has an advantage. It's there, it's local, and it thinks that it has enough military power to cause a lot of damage.
Now, the question is, why would Iran do that?
If there is a political crisis in the region, for instance, over Iran's nuclear ambitions, that in retaliation for economic sanctions against Iran imposed by the Security Council or anything like that, the Iranians might have some hit-and-run action in the Strait, whereby it would be extremely uncomfortable for ship owners to send their ships or tankers through the Straits.
The Iranian Revolutionary Guard specifically have been training for 10 years almost and developed an extensive fleet of very fast boats.
And it's deniable. You can say, no, it was not us. It was some sort of pirates that we see off the Somali coast or whatever. But it was still, everybody would know what was going to happen. It would be difficult to prove it. Life would become very uncomfortable, and again, prices will go through the roof.
Iran also, we should remember, is a high-cost producer. Unlike Saudi Arabia, where you stick a stick in the ground and oil comes out, or Iraq, which also has plenty of oil, Iran's oil is expensive. So it is in the Iranian interest to drive the price of oil up. So any kind of confrontation or hostilities around that region is in the Iranian interest. Iran is not interested in everything being peaceful and calm.
If it is Iran, which we suspect, right, that's unacceptable and something has to be done, and we're going to come in and clean it up. And if you get in our way, it's going to be a problem. I mean, the reality is you can't just let this occur.
We'd prefer to try to resolve the situation with a minimum amount of force, as always, but we're prepared to do what it takes to keep the place open.
For all traders, it was a day of panic. The price of Brent oil rocketed by 125% and is now up to $380 a barrel. The price of gold has doubled as investors search for a safe haven.
As soon as the geopolitical thermometer starts rising anywhere in the world, be it in Iran or in Nigeria or Venezuela, anywhere where oil is produced and the tension rises, so does the price. The Reuters screen or the Bloomberg screen or whatever sits on traders' desks, bomb explodes in wherever. Up goes the price instantly because people say, nervous, nervous, nervous. Political tension, how will it impact on oil? If they stop producing or if something happens, where will we go to find the extra oil? The spare capacity, the conviction that there is enough oil no matter what happens, that it will not go short of oil, that's a comfort cushion. Mm-hmm. And that needs to be big enough that the world can cope with a supply disruption somewhere in the world, is a comfort cushion, i.e. the spare capacity elsewhere in the world, big enough to replace that crude that suddenly has been taken off the market because of civil war or whatever.
The Persian Gulf oil would be stopped for a period of time. Could be days or could be longer. That immediately takes one quarter of the oil off the market in the world.
The point about the comfort cushion is that it is an insurance. If you yank the insurance away, people get frightened.
In Paris, energy ministers met today at an International Energy Agency meeting to discuss the release of the strategic oil reserves. Their emergency stocks can replace 90 days of oil output.
IEA, the International Energy Agency, which is a body under the OECD organization of industrialized countries, have in place legislation that binds its members to have, depending a little bit on countries, but broadly speaking, 90 days of oil supplies in reserve in their countries or in pipelines or companies or whatever.
The problem is, in many places, they're not at the level of 60-day, or as we wanted, 90-day supply. China doesn't have a big supply. Japan has some. Europe has pretty much like we do.
Several European countries are already facing serious fuel shortages. Britain, Italy and France have rationed their petrol at the pumps.
Sta bloccando il traffico a Roma in un modo impressionante. Ieri sono stata un'ora e mezza in fila in una vietta senza uscite per cercare di mettere benzina. Sono arrivata lì davanti e mi hanno detto che era finita.
In an oil crisis, you're talking about day to day. You're talking about transportation being disrupted. You are talking about the export of things being disrupted. You are talking about movement of merchandise across the oceans being interrupted. You are talking about air transportation being interrupted. It's a far greater serious because it's an existential crisis.
Spero si risolva più presto possibile perché non so come faremo a fare la spesa se anche il latte ieri mancava in un altro supermercato.
In a major oil supply crisis, the stress is overwhelming and everybody is running for their own barricade. And it was very interesting because I remember that the Russians said, okay, well, we have the strategic supply of oil that we can share with you, provided you recognize our sovereignty in Ukraine, the Caucasus, Central Asia. So they continued with their geopolitical agenda, generally speaking, not just with Russia. There was very little in terms of morals or ethics or morality when it comes to the dollars and cents of the oil business.
Akbar Islamia announced today on the internet that it will continue to disrupt oil supplies to what it calls the enemies of Islam. It says it plans to attack more strategic oil targets.
What happens if, for example, the big terminals of Ras Tanura or Abu Qaiq in Saudi Arabia get attacked and blown up? That may be, in a way, even worse than the Strait of Hormuz. Why? With the physical destruction of these terminals, it'll take 2, 3, 4, 5 years to rebuild them. Then we're looking at a massive game change in the world because the oil supply as we knew it will no longer exist. And that will drive our civilization back to the pre-energy or pre-oil, pre-transportation years.
The UN Security Council gathered today in New York for an emergency meeting to discuss the situation in the Persian Gulf.
The mechanism to get to that point where the world says, oh, hang on a second, we don't want this, is the UN Security Council. There's no other. It's ineffective. It's politically naive on occasion. On occasion, it's politically corrupt. But it's the only one we have.
So I would suspect the Security Council would make a pretty significant statement pretty early.
When was the last time you saw the United Nations people holding hand in hand around the Security Council?
They would spend days, if not months, haggling over it.
The draft resolution has been adopted as resolution 1591.
We all in the United States hope that this resolution will contribute to ending violence.
The history of the United Nations in handling crisis of this kind in the past 25 years is to be completely ineffective. The big scenario we are discussing is one of conflict. By definition, being united and being in conflict are a contradiction in terms. The Americans will attempt to get sanctions, including military sanctions, against Iran. Almost certainly the Russians and the Chinese will completely refuse.
Russia and China are both very serious allies of Iran, regardless of what the internal regime is, because they have their military sales at stake. Russia is selling billions of dollars worth of equipment to Iran. They are looking at massive Chinese economic development, including oil and gas.
So there's a very close state-to-state relationship between China and Iran, frequent visits back and forth, promises of close ties, and this has historically included military cooperation, arms transfers, and military technology. The Iranian military is equipped with Chinese military equipment and military technology.
The Security Council has issued a statement that it's working on a resolution with strong measures against Iran. Russia and China are more reluctant and will abstain from voting.
中方抵制住来自西方的压力，坚定立场，支持对伊朗进行军事制裁。中国驻联合国大使随之发表声明，详细解释了中方的立场。
The Security Council has adopted the resolution and China abstained. I think that you are clear that I've met the press several times, that from the very beginning that we find difficulties with the first draft that US presented. So that's why we find many elements in the draft, especially in the first few drafts, difficult for China to accept.
在对联合国决议投票时，中国表示弃权，并警告西方。对海湾地区进行军事制裁只会让当前的局势更加恶化。
If this is an indefinite, prolonged, nasty confrontation with uncertain outcome, everybody is going to hoard supplies. Everybody is going to fight against everybody else, and there the role of China is going to be very important.
I think China will take a very isolated view of that. It will protect its own interests.It will be very wary of being labeled an imperial power. They don't want that label. It will stick, but they don't want it. So they will be very careful of saying, we are not interfering in anybody else's business, whatever you do, rest of all, you can do whatever you like, but we will protect our interests.
And then the question is, does the US have a clout, a possibility to pressure Beijing and Moscow? And in my book,obviously with Beijing, that they owe so much of our debt. They have more than $1 trillion of the US debt. Our options there are very limited vis-a-vis China.
That's the major thing in the world, I think, by 2020 or 2025, will be, what is China going to be?Is China going to be an adversarial major power?
The main players on one side would be Russia and China and the Central Asian countries collaborating to supply each other with energy and to fend off the presence of the United States in Eurasia. That would be on one side.On the other side would be the United States, Japan, Australia, South Korea, maybe Taiwan, Singapore and Malaysia, the Philippines, coming around, and India as a counterblock trying to contain Chinese and Russian power.
Мы действительно находимся, скажем так, в протоблоке с Китаем, но не потому, что это нам хочется.Мы пытались 15 лет, даже больше, с конца 80-х годов, вступить в союз с Западом. Ничего, кроме пинков и плевков, мы от Запада за это время не видели. Да, ну и 11 миллионов загранпаспортов, выданных в Российской Федерации, да, правда, на 140 миллионов человек. И Запад очень внятно показал нам, что сотрудничество с Западом невозможно. Вот продавать газ, пожалуйста...Ограничивать ракеты, чтобы что-нибудь случайно не взорвалось, пожалуйста. Но вот стратегическое сотрудничество невозможно.
Central to all of this is the control over the sea lanes that are the way in which the energy flows, with the U.S. bloc trying to control...the sea lanes of communication, of transportation, and the Russia-China bloc developing internal lines of building new pipelines in Central Asia and Russia to diminish their reliance on sea power.
China is building enormous naval presence. For what? To protect the supply routes from West Africa and so on. So China is enormously focused.On a strategic need to secure energy supplies in the future.
As long as China doesn't have a massive fleet, what they'll do, they'll put a naval base, let's say, in Burma, and then in Seychelles Islands or somewhere there, and then all the way to Africa. So there'll be a chain of military bases that from those bases, they can project naval power with smaller ships.
And so this has become a justification for U.S. naval expansion. Chinese officials look at the American naval buildup and say, this is a threat to our national security. And in fact, the National Intelligence Council issued this year a scenario in 2025 in which U.S. and Chinese naval forces engage in a direct clash in the Indian Ocean over Persian Gulf oil supplies.
If U.S. and China are in a conflict over Middle Eastern oil, then probably two or three options present themselves. One, we find a solution. Somebody gets on the phone, somebody yells at the other guy, threatens the other guy threatens back. Then they send, you know, the equivalent of Dr. Kissinger, and some arrangement is worked out. Second, they don't find that arrangement, but nevertheless, people don't shoot at each other. People are saying, look, both Americans and Chinese are rational players. We don't want the nuclear war. But, you know, world wars started on smaller things than confrontation on the lifeblood of the global economy.
This is the big worry. So that the U.S. and China, which need this vast amount of imported oil, will be competing with one another for a diminishing of supply of exportable oil. And I foresee a situation developing already where the U.S. and China are competing for this oil by forming military alliances, competing with one another with arms transfers, with promises of military training and military support, so militarizing the competition.
All over the world, you see Chinese presence that does economic development. But it will change because the sword will follow the yuan.
中国国家通讯社新华社近日报道， 中国人民解放军的南方部队已经从中国在巴基斯坦的瓜达尔基地出发前往波斯湾。 中国国家主席赖长寿今天在纽约联合国总部的紧急会议中提出，中国不寻求与西方的对抗，但是考虑到中国的国家安全，必须保证中国从该地区获得应有的石油供给。此外，由于海湾地区的紧张局势，该地区到中国及东方的石油供给已经暂时中断，因此国家能源部近日下令，除非获得紧急行车批准，任何人禁止开车上路。
I think the only people who have a contingency plan, and it's a limited one, are the Americans. I think the Europeans have been, in many ways, in a coma when it comes to the idea of conflict at all. Their whole thinking is no conflict.
In the United States, there's a toll-free number called 1-800. You dial the number 1-800, you get a toll-free number. Well, I think the world thought of the United States as dial 1-800-US-Navy. That was every time there was a problem in the world, they'd expect the Navy to be out there and take care of it.
But I think you should think about this not only as a service that the United States performs for the rest of the world, but also as a hidden threat that it holds over the rest of the world, mm-hmm. that a kind of insurance, and it's a threat to Europe and to Japan that you cannot stray too far from us in your foreign policy and key issues, because the day may come when you call 1-800-US-Navy and we will not respond.
And I think the Europeans, in effect, in the end, will prove to be completely paralyzed. They don't have a strategy. Their only strategy is it will not happen. And let's pray that it doesn't happen if we believe in anything to pray to. And then in the end of the day, let's hope the Americans can solve it. But that's not the strategy.
The diagnosis is clear. Europe is vulnerable. And if we don't want to be left out in the cold, we have to act, and act fast.
We are in a transition period from reliance on traditional fuels, fossil fuels, oil, coal, and natural gas. We know that at some point in this century, they will cease to be the major source of energy and alternatives will be the main source of energy. But the transition is taking too long, and I'm afraid it will drag out and we'll have an intermediate period from 2010 to 2050 or so, in which there's this real risk of conflict over the remaining fossil fuels. That's the danger period.
Het gaat om de zorg of je de volgende generatie in Nederland, als je ervan uitgaat dat energie een basisinput is, dezelfde welvaart zou kunnen bieden en dezelfde vrijheid in termen van mobiliteit. En dat het niet verworden is tot een enorm strijdgebied waarbij het er misschien niet altijd is of niet voldoende is. Er is heel veel mogelijk met duurzame technologie, maar dan moet je ook wel investeren in het mogelijk maken. Maar ik zie dat niet gebeuren. En we zullen toch met z'n allen die investering moeten maken. Voor onszelf, maar vooral voor onze kinderen en kindskinderen, om die klik te maken. En ja, we kunnen 100 keer roepen, worden kenniseconomie. Maar eigenlijk alles wat we roepen, dat kost investering en het kost wat. En dat betekent dat we dat met z'n allen moeten opbrengen. En als je dan in een hele korte termijn gedreven en tamelijk individualistische samenleving leeft, dan weet ik niet of we dit publieke goed met z'n allen gaan produceren.
What we have to do is to shorten that intermediate period as much as possible by accelerating the introduction of the alternatives. We're not introducing them, we're not developing them fast enough. It's stretching out, it's going to take too long. We have to quadruple, tenfold increase in investment in the alternatives so they become available on a very large scale much sooner, before oil runs out. That's what we have to do.
Do not believe the lies. Do not be naive.
I need to tell you something. It's about me and...
And no one is innocent.
Send me your email address. I'll get you the files. You'll know what I know. You'll see what I see.